Hi guys, I hope you're doing really well and practicing radical self-care. In this video, I had somebody ask for me to make a video on sort of like the internet dating and narcissism and sort of the new cultural norms we have where people are sleeping around a lot and you know, what my take is on that. And so I'll do my best. This is, again, it's sort of off the cuff, but I believe that, yes, I think the internet dating sites there are a lot of narcissists on those sites. It doesn't mean that there aren't normal people. I've been on there. Lots of my good friends have been on there that are really good, solid, healthy, kind, decent people. But I think there definitely are narcissists on these dating sites. And it's hard when you're, especially if you're like trying to get into the dating world and you're trying to figure out, oh my gosh, is this person a narcissist? Are they not? And I think instead of looking to see if somebody is a narcissist or not, and I know this is very, very hard if you're fresh out of these relationships or if you've taken a break and now you're trying to date again, like you're afraid of getting with another narcissist. And we tend to be, survivors tend to be very hyper vigilant. We're like, you know, we're pretty, we were hurt so badly by the experience that we went through that we don't want to put ourselves into that situation again, right? So we tend to be hypervigilant. Our nervous system is hypervigilant. If you have complex PTSD, you have just a lot of anxiety in your nervous system, right? So we do want to balance, like, what's my intuition versus my trauma response? And it's going to be really hard to tell the difference. I speak from personal experience, but one thing I think to notice is, you know, there's a few things. Like, if somebody only wants to text and they don't want to talk on the phone, that can be a bit of a red flag. If they're texting and if it's like intermittent reinforcement from the get-go, then that's a bit of a red flag. But I think it's super important that you talk to the people on the phone and you are very careful when you're first dating them that you do not overshare. And I am so guilty about this because I am like such a codependent. I'm in a 12-step recovery program. So I'm very like used to being open and maybe even, you know, I'm pretty authentic, but I'm maybe too open. I'm too open about like my trauma and what I've been through. And I have had to learn, and I'm still struggling with learning this, but like the hard way, that people have to be able to earn trust. And nobody has just the rights to access to you. They actually have to earn that. So I think it's really important when you're first going out on dates with people that you do not overshare. And if you're a codependent that wants to be seen, you want to be heard, you want to be understood, probably because you were neglected as a child, you had a lot of invalidation from the narcissistically abusive relationship, that you just want to be understood, you want to be seen, you want to be heard. But not everyone has the right to that. Not everyone has earned the right to actually see you or know you or get access to you. That happens slowly over time when trust is getting built. So I think it's a good idea to talk to people on the phone, try to get a sense of who they are without oversharing. And, you know, ask a lot of questions. I think it's important that you get with somebody who's very authentic about and honest about talking about why their past relationships failed, and that they've been able to introspect and self-reflect, and they're able to tell you their part in why it failed. Not just the other person was crazy, the other person was, it was all their fault, the other person did this or did that. Like, are you able to look at yourself? And I know for me, for sure, in the relationship I was in, like, I know part of the reason it failed was because I had to discover that I was deeply codependent, and my codependent was so pervasive and throughout my life without even really realizing it, that my part was I didn't set healthy boundaries. I I stayed in a position to be hurt for the possibility of love and approval. I kept trying to earn my worth. I thought that love had to be earned, and I ignored red flags. And I also didn't know that silent treatment, stonewalling, I didn't know that those things were abuse. You know, I really didn't. I didn't know that just being ignored for weeks or whatever was abuse. But I actually didn't even realize when I was in it that it was like deliberate silent treatment. I didn't get that there was a game that was being played. I guess on some level I was like dense myself. Like, I just didn't get it. But now I know that if you ask somebody a direct question and they respond with anger or evasiveness, and they don't answer it, or they're vague, like, that's not okay. Like, if you ask somebody a direct question, they should answer the question. Now, that is if you're in a long-term relationship or whatever. Now, early on, when you're dating somebody, like on these internet sites or whatever, it's okay if somebody asks you a direct question, or if you ask them a direct question and they say, you know, I'm not really comfortable disclosing that or talking about that on our first date. Let's save that for a couple of dates down the road, right? That's okay, right? That's a boundary, but it's a fine line, right? So I think it's very important when you're first dating people, like, notice, like, when you first talk to them on the phone, like, are they just talking about themselves, or are they asking you questions? Do they show a genuine curiosity about who you are as a separate human being? Or are they just playing off everything you say so that they can hijack the conversation and make it about them? Are they only talking about themselves, what they've done, where they've been, who they are? If they're only talking about themselves, that can be a red flag, right? It doesn't guarantee that they're a narcissist, but it can be a red flag. Like, are they asking you questions about yourself? Are they curious? Are they showing curiosity about who you are as a human, right? But also, if they don't ask any questions, or if they don't talk about themselves at all, and they're only asking you questions, and they're deflecting when you ask them questions, that can be a sign of somebody who's even more disturbed, like a little bit more sociopathic, where they're data mining and they're trying to get information about you. So I think it's fine on the first couple of dates to really just keep things light. You can ask them questions, but, you know, about them, but also be very careful about what you're disclosing. Do not talk about your trauma. Do not talk about the fact that you were married to a narcissist or a psychopath or sociopath. Be very, 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 very careful about that stuff. And try to get to know them and listen to your intuition. What is your body telling you? How does your body feel? Are you having fun with this person? Are you laughing? Is there humor? Is there a lightness about it? Is there like an engagement that feels good, right? Check in with yourself. If there's incredible intensity and you're like that, if you're a codependent and they're a narcissist, I mean, Ross Rosenberg talks about the human magnet syndrome, that you're gonna be like really intensely attracted, right? So if that's happening, that's also a red flag. If you walk out of it and you're like, you feel like you were just like with this person, that's something to also pay attention to. Now, early signs when you're dating early on in the relationship is they're texting and calling all day long, messages, calling, texting. That's a red flag. That's love bombing, right? If they're telling you that they love you after a few weeks or in a very short amount of time, that you're their soulmate, you're the love of their life. And if they're saying that and they don't know how you take your coffee, they don't know what your middle name is, they don't even know where you grew up, they don't know you, and they're telling you that they're madly and like crazy in love with you, like, again, red flag. Like, somebody cannot love you if they don't know you, right? And if they're not even curious about you or asking questions about you or wanting to find out who you are, then how can they possibly love you? That is not love, not in my opinion anyway. So those are some of the signs to look for. Obviously, somebody asked about somebody who slept around a lot on the dating. Now, for me, I'm monogamous. I like to, you know, only be in a relationship with one other person. I don't sleep around with a bunch of people at the same time. That's just like disturbing to me, for me, right? Everyone has their own norms in that regard. But for me, if that's my core value, that I am like a monogamous, committed person, then I should be pretty careful about dating somebody who doesn't share that core value, right? So the person, you know, one of you guys asked about, well, what about somebody who's like slept around a lot on these internet dating sites? Well, if your core value is that you're a monogamous, committed sort of, you want emotional intimacy along with the physical intimacy. You don't just want somebody who's like, you know, sleeping with a bunch of people for also for STD reasons or whatever. Then even if they're a narcissist or not, that's almost beside the point. The point is they're not matching you at your core value where you are, right? They're not matching you. So that might be somebody who isn't really sharing your core value. I'm always a little bit trepidatious about that because for me, like, you know, I want somebody who's capable of building and developing like a really, truly, deeply connected, emotionally intimate relationship along with the physical intimacy. So, you know, obviously you guys know that with narcissists, they really try to rush the sex. And, you know, and because they know that's a bonding chemical, right? That'll get you bonded to them. Now, obviously, some of us, we're human. We have human emotions. You can be very lonely when you come out of these relationships. So it's not unheard of for normal people to also have sex on the first or second date. I'm not saying that only narcissists do that, certainly not, but it's a good idea to try to have that boundary and try to keep it in place. And I know it's not easy, and I'm not, you know, look, we've all done what we've done, and sometimes when you're lonely, you seek that companionship. But I really think that is a good boundary for you to have, is, you know, no intimacy right away. Really wait and slow that stuff down, slow down that part of it, and really be careful about, you know, maintaining healthy boundaries in relationships. And you'll notice narcissists have massive boundary problems themselves. They do. They are not, you know, part of it, they're not very good at setting boundaries, but also they are very bad at violating other people's boundaries. Like, their expertise is figuring out a way around your boundary, or to, sometimes they bulldoze through it, sometimes they manipulate around it. So, you know, narcissists have boundary issues as well. Codependents definitely do. We're bad at like setting boundaries, sticking to boundaries. You know, we're bad at enforcing consequences. Like, this is all challenging for us, but narcissists have their own issues with boundaries. And most of that, really involves them like being really bad about violating other people's boundaries. But I also think they struggle setting healthy boundaries themselves. So, you know, you can see that kind of go both ways. But yeah, in terms of the dating sites, I would just be really careful and try to vet somebody. Remember, people have to earn trust. It is earned slowly over time through consistent, reliable, dependable behaviors, slowly over time, by making sure their actions and their words match, slowly over time. Okay, thanks so much, and hope you guys are practicing radical self-care. Bye.